because there weren't enough details in the communicated issue for us to know. But I think whatever your politics, you should be glad you met. That's what I think. I think it's important to that you understand what the actual threat from North Korea, the small country of, you know, 20-some million people that can't feed itself or stay warm in the winter without help, but is good at making bombs and missiles. Sounds weird. Partly it's because of the topography of the country. It's very mountainous. And partly it's because they haven't modernized any of their economic processes. So the reason that you don't want them to have nuclear weapons and really good long-range missile technology is one, they know if they use a nuclear weapon, it's the end of their country. So that's not as big a danger as them selling the technology from the missiles or the fuel. If you have nuclear weapons, you have to have extra fissile material, the stuff that makes the bomb go boom. And if you have that separate, you can make small, dirty bombs or suitcase nukes, and they can cause a lot of damage. And if you can't feed yourself in a tight, you might sell that stuff. That should bother you. But the dictators club in the world today now believes that if you want to stay in, even if people hate your guts, the one sure insurance policy is nuclear weapons, because they believe they can convince the rest of the world that if they're going out anyway, they might as well take as many people with them as possible. So for example, they believe that Ukraine made a mistake when I was president and Boris Yeltsin was president of Russia. I convinced the president of Ukraine to give up his nuclear weapons and under something called the Non-Nuclear Act. And Senator Nunn's here tonight. And they put all the nuclear weapons into Russia, into an international inspection site. And to the best of our knowledge, nothing bad's ever happened. But Vladimir Putin decided not to honor Yeltsin's commitment never to mess with the Ukraine's territorial integrity. So he took Crimea and sent forces into eastern Ukraine. They believe, the dictators club, that Putin might not have risked that if they kept nuclear weapons. A lot of people believe that Gaddafi would still be ruling Libya if he had not given up his nuclear weapons to Tony Blair. I don't necessarily believe either one of those things, but I'm just telling you they do. So Kim Jong-un is sitting here thinking, I'm running a military dictatorship. I killed a bunch of people to get in power, to solidify my power, and to show the military I was serious. If I give up all my nuclear weapons and my missile technology, what have I got to show for it? How did we get as far as we have? I think two reasons. One is the president of South Korea is the first president since Kim Dae-jung in my second term who actually wants to get along with North Korea and doesn't want the whole expense and political headache of trying to take him over. So he's a hero in all this, if you believe, as I do, it's a good thing to talk. Because he got North Korea into the Olympics. They had some joint teams, well, it's separate teams. And the only thing that's really disturbing about this is that President Trump announced the cessation of our military exercises with them, apparently without talking to him in advance. Because none of this would have happened. He built up President Trump and built up Kim Jong-un and said, you two were made for each other and all that. This is not a bad thing. And I think it may be the only negotiations I can think of where Kim Jong-un might be willing to give up his nuclear capacity and his missile capacity, because he thinks President Trump likes dictators better than Democrats. I mean, put yourself in this guy's position. He's running a country with a 21st century missile and nuclear capacity and a barely early 20th century economic capacity. So they meet, and then they